Hey everyone, welcome back to the channel. In this video, I'll show you how to create a 360 degree virtual terrain for you to use in KStars 3.5.3. So without any further ado, let's get started. This video has turned out a lot longer than my previous videos. I'm trying to be as concise as possible. Still, I don't want to take too many shortcuts because they can create confusion. Here you can see at what points in the video I'll start the three main phases of this process. You can always refer to the detailed chapter markers that I've added in the description of this video. I'll show you how to use the Google Streetview app to take a 360 degree image for free on pretty much any smartphone. But since I happen to own a dedicated 360 degree camera and I would prefer to use it for my own setup, I'll quickly demonstrate that workflow as well. For image editing, you can use your favorite image editor. I'll demonstrate GIMP in this video since it is free and available for PC, Mac and Linux. But of course you can perform all of these actions in Affinity Photo or Photoshop and probably a lot other image editors as well. To create the 360 degree image, you can follow a few simple steps. It makes sense to take the image on the same spot or close to where you usually place your telescope. From that position, see if you can find something on the horizon that represents north and try to mark it so that you can use it to align your image later in the process. You open up the Google Streetview app on your phone and press the Create button on the bottom of your screen. Now select Photosphere and point your camera towards the north marker. The orange dot will gradually turn white and you'll know that the first image is successful. Now rotate your body until the camera is aligned with the second orange dot and just continue until you have captured the entire sphere. When you take your first image, be sure to point your phone straight to the horizon, preferably to the north marker. The 360 degree image format is designed to have the horizon or 0 degree altitude running through the middle of the image. If your first image is not pointing north, no problem, you can easily adjust the offset in azimuth in KStars. But if the horizon is too high or too low, you will need to adjust your image in GIMP to have it in the middle of the image. Once you're done with the sphere, press the green check mark. When back in the menu, press the profile button in the lower right. Once the image is finished processing, tap the image thumbnail to open the image and double check. Do not press the publish button. If you are happy with the image, you can share it by pressing the share button in the orange bar on the bottom. Now you can choose a method to share it privately. The image we're creating in this video will be used for my actual setup, so I would like to get the best quality I can get. Now, I happen to own a 360 degree camera, so it makes sense that I'll use it for this virtual terrain. In general, the use of a 360 degree camera is a little faster and easier. And in situations where there are elements close to the camera, a 360 degree camera creates a more accurate horizon. Okay, so here we are in GIMP. GIMP is a free open source application that's available for both Mac, PC and Linux. And you can find the link to the download page below this video in the description. I'll start by showing you a quick and dirty way to remove the sky. And after that, I'll demonstrate a couple of things you can do to improve the image if you don't mind spending a little bit more time. This is the image we took with the Google Streetview app. When we inspect the image, you can see that it's not perfect. But really, it doesn't have to be for our purposes. The horizon is just going to be a reference and most of the time we will actually be looking at the sky. But you can see that there are some problems with the stitching, especially in the areas that are closer to the lens. And here, around the corner of my shed, you can see that we have the biggest problem of the image. Actually, I've taken the image two or three different times, and every time I got the exact same results. I think it has to do with the parallax between the different angles when I was taking the pictures. And that's most pronounced with elements that are closer to the center of the photosphere. But really, it's not a problem. And if it does really bother you, you can fill in the gaps with a paintbrush or apply some more advanced image editing. But I won't show you how to do that in this tutorial. Let's just look at how to remove the sky. First, you will navigate to the layer panel on the lower right corner here. This is where you can see the layers of your image. Right now, there's only one. Click it with the right mouse button and add the alpha channel. If, later on, you need to check if your image already has an alpha channel, you can right-click it again, and you can see that the option to add the alpha channel is gray, and removing the alpha channel is available. So that's how you know that the image already has an alpha channel. Now, what we will do next is we will grab the fuzzy select tool here in the upper left panel, and we make sure to have anti-alias, feathered edges, and draw mask enabled. And all I do now is I click on a patch of sky, and when I move my mouse downwards, you select more of the sky, while if you move your mouse up, you select less of the sky. So now it's basically doing a dance and find the ideal selection. And I think, given the problems that we have over here, that this is a very good selection. You can look at some of the edges. You are never going to get all these small leaves over here, but you do see that our selection is punching some holes into the canopy and that it has very nice edges over there. Also, it's not eating into the roof too much. So I think this is a pretty decent selection. And now, you just press the delete button on your keyboard and basically you're done. You can repeat this, but you will need to unselect everything first. Go to selection, select none, and the shortcut for this is Control Shift A or Command Shift A. Then you can select another area if you have some clouds like I do here and just remove those. And you can just go over it again and maybe some of the edges over here. And once you've done that for the entire image, all you have to do is export. If this is all you need for your terrain, feel free to navigate to the timestamp I show you on screen and you'll see the rest of the process. However, if you want to put a little bit more effort into your virtual terrain, just keep watching. For this, I'll use the image I've taken with the Insta360 camera. It doesn't have the problem with the corner of my shed, which justifies the effort a little bit more. We'll start out the same. We add an alpha channel to this image, and you can take the fuzzy select tool. You'll check anti-aliasing, feathered edges, and draw mask. And you select a piece of sky. That was a little much, so let me just go back in there. And don't want to trim the trees here too much. And let me just try that again. I think that's good for first pass. Yeah, that part looks good. Delete that. Go to the other patch, delete that. Delete some of the clouds. Okay. I think we got most of it. Now I'll go to foreground color and I pick the very bright magenta. Press OK and I'll create a new layer down here. I'll call it background and I'll choose to fill it with the foreground color, which is that bright magenta that we just picked. Press OK and now the new layer is on top of the other image. So I'll just move it down by pressing the down arrow. And now it's very easy to see exactly where you have some parts that you haven't cleaned up correctly. Let me just break my selection here a little bit because I would like to show you what you can do if you have some holes in your mask. Sometimes when you're too aggressive with your selection, you create holes in your mask like this. Now, right click on the image layer. So not on the background, but on the image. And we can choose add a layer mask. And we'll create this layer mask by transferring the layer's alpha channel. Press add. And now in the lower corner over here, you can see that besides the image itself, we also have this black and white mask next to it. And you can edit this mask by painting over it with either a black or a white brush. So I'm going to select my brush. I always forget whether black is a positive or a negative over here. So Black makes it transparent. So you can change the brush size with the open brackets and closing brackets. And let me just paint over this area with my brush. Also here. You can see that over there we have some holes in the mask. And I prefer not to have those. So by pressing the X key, you can see that the foreground color and the background color switch. So now I have white selected. And you can go over this area and fill the holes up again. So maybe just go over there. Yeah. So maybe I'll just go over all the edges of the horizon. And those are the most important to me. So these are the two holes that we punched in specifically to demonstrate this. And let me fill those up for you. These edges don't really matter, but well, since we're here, might as well clean them up a bit. Here we have a couple more. Let me just grab my black brush. Now here you can see that we actually went a little bit too far with the fuzzy selection tool. But honestly, don't spend too much time on these leaves because they will take a lot of time and they will never be perfect. Okay. Let's call it a day. I think that's good enough. Now, there are just a couple more things that I will do to finish up the image. Let's do some image editing. So first, let's go to the color curves. And in the color curves, I will drag down the brightness. that's wrong. Did you see what's happening? I still have my mask selected instead of my image layer. So let's just cancel this and now select the image layer and not the mask. Go to color curves and let's bring down the brightness a bit here. Let's put in a nice gamma curve, crushing some of those shadows. Yeah, that's nice. Now, the second thing I'll do is I go to the saturation settings, and currently saturation is set to 1. And let's bring it back to around 0.5. And now as a third setting, go to the color temperature, and in the intended temperature, I'll just drag it to the left a little. So this I think is way too much, but just a little bit to maybe give me that illusion of imaging under a full moon. Okay. I don't know if you can see it on the screen recording, but in the beginning we actually marked north on my fence. So now I'll just pick a color. Let's take this blue for instance, and I'll grab my brush. Let's make it a little smaller and just highlight this north reference. And finally, I just realized that these 360 degree images can become very big. Perhaps you can see it over here in the title bar, but I'll show you here in the scale image dialog as well. This image, which is taken with my Insta360 camera, has a width of 6,080 pixels and a height of 3,040 pixels, which is great if you want to take professional 360 degree images, but not so much when you're running K-Stars on a machine that's less powerful, perhaps a Raspberry Pi or something like that. You might want to downscale this image, and you can do that here in this dialog. Let me show you again where it is. It's here underneath Image, Scale Image, and let's say I want to output this image to 25% of the original. I'll change the 6,080 to 3,040, and you'll see that it automatically scales the height of the image to match the width. And when I press Scale, I get an image that's a quarter of the size as the original. And this might actually run a lot smoother on machines with less graphic capabilities. And while this is the Insta360 image, I'll quickly show you the Street View version as well. Here the sizes are even larger. The width is over 8,000 pixels wide and it's over 4,000 pixels high, which is pretty big for our purposes. Now that your image has the right size, all you have to do is export the file as a PNG file. Go to File, Export. It's very important that you export it as a PNG file. PNG files support transparency, and that's something that you're going to need in this case. Also, KStars currently only supports PNG files, as far as I know. By default, GIMP wants to export a JPEG, so you will navigate to select file type by extension and select one of them, press the P from PNG, and then select the PNG file format. Now, give your image a name, so let's call it Backyard 360 Summer, and let me just save it to my desktop here. Export. The default settings are fine. Export. And now we will pick it up in KStars. So here we are on my astrophotography laptop, and I'll open up KStars 3.5.3. The rest is actually really simple. You just open up the settings, go to KStars, configuration, go to the terrain tab. And here you now have the option to show the terrain and to navigate to a terrain image. And as you can see, KStars now has a terrain folder. And I have my image here in the documents folder. So let me just select that image and copy the file to the terrain folder. Now select it and press apply. And you can see that the 360 degree image has been applied to my horizon in KStars. One thing we need to make sure is to align our north reference with north in KStars. Of course, you can bring in an image without a north reference and just align it by observing a star and matching it with your horizon in KStars. But we have added the marker, and in this case, we are only a couple of degrees off. But it's possible to have a very large offset. So in this case, I'll just try -1, press apply. Ah, that's the right direction, but it's a little bit more than a degree. So let me just go to -5 there. Oh, I just overshot north there. So perhaps -4 then. Ah yeah, it's somewhere in between -4 and -5, but this is good enough. And one of the cool things now is that now that you have this horizon, it's actually interesting to start playing with some of these projection types. So you have a different methods of projecting the sky, but now that I always have the reference of my own backyard, I can actually see how much of the sky is being skewed. So also, now that I will be spending a lot more time in KStars to plan my sessions, it might be interesting to create your own color scheme for all the elements in the sky chart. Anyway, this video has gone on long enough. If you stayed around until the end, thank you very much for watching. I hope you found this video useful. If you did, please consider giving it a like. Leave your comments in the comments, and I hope to see you soon. Take care.